discussion. It is my real pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Slovenian institution, Tomaž Pisanski, who is well known in the lower dimension of geometry, topology, graph theory. He was educated from two universities, from the University of Slovenia and also from the Slovenian State University. So that he has two education, like a journalism teacher, and also like an expert in computer science. Also, it's well known fact is his father and founded on two big schools of graph theory in Slovenia and also in Slovakia. At the same time, he produced very nice theories related to the existence of Hamiltonian cycles and also some new methods of how to calculate the general graph in very difficult situations. Also, he is very nice organizer. He organized the main conference in Slovenia and also in Europe. I should say that it's also, that he is founder of the Academy of Mathematical Chemistry, and he was the chairman of this academy for many years. And so now it's my pleasure to say that today he is talking for us about symmetries and combinatorics of finite antilattices.
Yeah, you should turn it on. Turn it on. No.
Now? Okay. Thank you very much for this kind introduction. Things work better if they're turned on. So, I would like to start with thanking my co-authors and future co-authors who contributed to this. The papers are not written yet, so what we have is just a preview. But I would like to thank to all my sponsors who contributed to this. In particular, the bilateral civilian Russian bank, Sasha. So this is my third visit to Novosibirsk, and I'm glad to see so many old friends here and meet new ones. I would like to thank the organizers, in particular Elena and Karin, for inviting me and sponsoring my visit, and for being such a wonderful host. I would like to congratulate the organizers for the professional and very high quality of this G2 event achieved in such a short time. Last but not least, my thanks go to Sasha Ivanov, with sincere hopes that he will look favorably on my contribution for the conference proceedings. I have some suggestion. When I sent this picture to my family at home, they said, "Is this Siberia? I mean, you should advertise this much more. You should make it, obligatory for every participant here to visit this wonderful sandy beach here, very close to Academy Borodov." Okay, so motivation for my talk are lattices. What is a lattice? A lattice has, as we know, two operations, binary operations, meet and join, and they obey certain laws. I've written here four of them. Actually, there are a pair of laws, associativity and idempotence. But then there are two more pairs. One is commutativity, and the other pair is the absorption. There is a pair of dual absorption laws. Okay. So the question is, what happens if you throw away some of these axioms? For instance, if you just look at the first four axioms, then you get something which is known as non-commutative lattice. So in this case, It is the structure is called non-commutative lattice or double band. I'll explain what double band is. Actually, such a non-commutative lattice is called an anti-lattice if the operations satisfy two more identities, number 9 and number 10. So 1, 2, 4 plus number 9 and number 10. Now we know what an anti-lattice is, okay? But if you replace this 9 and 10 with this equivalence 11, then you get the most general, let's say, non-commutative lattice that has been studied extensively. There are many papers on so-called quasi lattices. But this is too big for us. We just go to anti-lattices. That's a very small class of non-commutative lattices. And you observe that this is under 11. This is equivalence. This is not an identity. So it's an equivalence. It's not an identity. Let's go even back. Let's go to magma. What is magma? Magma is a set equipped with a binary operation defined everywhere. So this is magma, right? No other conditions. But then you may have some conditions. For instance, number 12, this is associativity. Then you get a semigroup. You have so associativity and interpotence. Then you get what I called earlier a band. So the band is a semigroup which is in which every element is idempotent. Finally, you have this funny third condition here, the green one. BAB equals E. And this is what we call rectangularity condition. Okay? If this condition is satisfied in a band, then we call such a band rectangular. Okay? Now, let's go make a little excursion to universal algebra. If you have structures such as band, anti-lattices, quasi-lattices, semigroups, or whatever, then they will be considered as algebras in the sense of universal algebra. And part of that description is the so-called signature. What is signature? Basically, it tells you what are the arities of your operations. For instance, magma, band, or semigroup, they have just one binary operation, so the signature is 2. If you have a monoid, that is half. That is a semigroup with identity, then you have the signature is 2 and 0, because you have that identity that's a 0 parity, and so on. For instance, Boolean algebra is more complicated. It's 2, 2, and then 1 for negation, and 0, 0 for two constants. Okay? Now, there is another important concept in the theory of universal algebra, and that is the concept of variety. So what is a variety? If you have a collection of structures, of algebras, with the same signature, and that collection is closed undertaking homomorphic images, substructures, or direct products, then such a thing is called variety. It has some nice properties, okay? So if we are dealing only with finite structures, so then we are not allowed to have a general direct product, but just finite direct product. In this case, these are called pseudo variety, okay? Finite-like varieties. And there are two fundamental theorems which are very important. And the first one was due to Garrett Birkhoff from 35, which is called the Birkhoff HSP theorem, which is, now think, very important. It says a collection of algebras of the same signature is a variety that is closed under substructures, homomorphic images, and products, if and only if it can be described by a collection of identities. So if you just give the identities, you know that you have a variety. You don't have to check whether these things are satisfied, because they are going to be satisfied according to Birkhoff theory. So that's very important. Now, quasi metaphysics, remember, there was an equivalence, it was not identity. But you can replace this equivalence by the identities 15 and 16, and this shows the quasi-lattices form variety. Okay? Now, another thing is very well known, everybody knows it, but I just repeat it. You use it in groups probably, but in universal algebra it goes like that. If you have a homomorphism between two algebras, A and B, of the same signature, of course, then you have this picture here. So A is a little larger, B is a little smaller, and then the image is a substructure in B. And then if you take any element in the image and you go back, you get a set of pre-images, okay? And if you think a little bit, you will see that these pre-images will partition, will be equivalence classes in your original algebra. And they are not equivalences only, they are congruences. So they are compatible with all operations in your universal algebra. And that's very important, okay? And not only that, now, if you take your algebra and you shrink these congruence classes to points, to elements, then you get a so-called quotient algebra, which is isomorphic to the image, of course. Everybody knows that. For groups, we know what happens there, right? You have to take here, for instance, on the right-hand side, you have to take the identity, and you go back, and the pre-image will be a normal subgroup. Okay? And, right? So, studying homomorphic images is the same thing as studying quotient structures. So we don't have to go very far if you want to know what are the homomorphic images. So this is the same thing as studying congruences. You don't have to go very far. You are just saying, hey. In other words, all information about the potential homomorphic images resides in A alone. You don't have to go far away. So the role of B is simply to select feasible homomorphic images out of all potential homomorphic images that are already in A. Okay, so there are three important lattices. I'm just going to say these are the equivalence relations, the important lattice, congruence relations, formal lattice, and all substructures, sub-algebras in a given algebra, they also form lattice. But here you have to have also the empty set to be the bottom. Okay, now let's go back to bands. Why are bands interesting? If you look at the congruences in bands, what you're going to see, and I give you a proof here, that each congruence class is a band. That's more powerful than for groups. For groups, there will be cosets. There won't be groups, but it will be cosets. But for bands, everything is a band itself. Every congruence class is a band itself. Okay, now another important result about bands that is due to people who are working in semigroup theory is that if you take the variety, first of all, bands form a variety because they were defined by two identities, associativity and idempotence. So they form a variety. Now the question is, what are possible subvariety of bands? And it turns out that each subvariety needs only one extra identity. Only one extra identity, so you need three identities to tell which subvariety of bands you have. And there is one particular case, this is the red one, so if you add this identity, these bands are called regular bands. And now, if you look just at the sub-varieties of regular bands, this is the picture that you get, okay? So there are 13 sub-varieties here of bands, okay? Now, they have names, and I'll just mention two. I'll mention semilattices, these are commutative bands, And I'll take not just the opposite, these are the rectangular bands. Remember, rectangular band is the one that has x, y, x equals to x. So that's also important. When we define antilattices, this is what we were talking about. Okay, let's go to band again. And let's go to rectangular bands. What it happens is the following. Each rectangular band, I'm talking about finite rectangular band now, can be described by an array, by a matrix. You place the element in that matrix. So each element appears exactly once. Okay? And the operation that you do is the following. You take an element x, you take an element y, and you take the row and the column, and this is the intersection is then x dot y. How do you get y dot x? You take the row of y, the column of x, and this is y dot x. So it's non-commutative. But this tells you exactly what a rectangular band is. So rectangular band can be described by rectangular matrices in which each element appears exactly once. And now one can define the type of rectangular band. P is the number of rows, Q is the number of columns, and PQ is now the type of rectangular band. And if you have two rectangular bands of different type, they are not isomorphic. But if you take two rectangular bands of the same type, they are always isomorphic. So there is nothing in there, right? Okay. So if you have these isomorphism classes of rectangular bands, and you can then calculate them. One has to be careful when I say isomorphic. There is no automorphism, but there is isomorphism between them. If you want to do automorphism of rectangular bands, then you have to define the equivalent generating matrices, and then two matrices are equivalent. If you can compute the columns and rows simultaneously and move one to the other one. Two equivalent the generating matrices define the same rectangular band. So there are different matrices which define the same rectangular. So there are PQ factorial, P factorial times Q factorial distinct rectangular bands, but they're all isomorphic. But they're distinct. Okay? You can put this matrix into a standard form so that you you compute it so that the first row and the first column are in increasing order. For instance, here we have a matrix and then we compute it into a standard form. There is also another form which is not equivalent to the standard form, and this is, let's call it, pro-canonical form. This is the form in which you just place the elements in the increasing order in the first row, second row, you just put them like that, right? So that would be a canonical form. Automorphism group rectangular, that's easy. But now antilattices. So when we define antilattices, actually what we said is antilattices is nothing else but a pair of rectangular bands on the same set, underlying set. So any rectangular double band is an antilattice. Now, if you have an antilattice, then you have two matrices. One is for meet, and one is for join. And any pair of such matrices with the same element, right, defines an antilattice. And now you have four parameters, P, Q, R, S, and that quadruple is the type of the antilattice. Okay? That's a bad idea, of course. So this is what you have here on the blackboard. In case you don't see it, this is what I draw here. But of course, P times Q must be equal to R times S because we have the same set. Now, why are antilattices important? Remember, at the beginning I said quasi-lattices are the most general non-commutative lattices that are worth studying. And there is a very important theorem which says, this is this one, Lazarus theorem, which says the following: any quasi-lattice is a lattice of antilattices. In other words, if you draw a Hasse-like diagram of a quasi-lattice, then you have these clouds there, and you have real Hasse diagram, lattice-like, between these clouds, but each cloud is an antilattice. And that's a characterization, so any quasi-lattice can be written in this way. That's why antilattices are important. There are flat antilattices. Flat antilattices are either row matrices or column matrices. So both matrices must be either row-row, row-column, column-row, or column-column. So there are four types of flat antilattices. There are so-called skew and skew star antilattices. I'm not going to go into this, but skew lattices have been studied even more than quasi-lattices. So a lot is known about skew lattices. How do you define direct product of antilattices? Well, all you have to do, if you have the generating matrices for both lattices, you take the tensor product of the two matrices, M times M and J times M, J, and you get in this way a direct product. So, for instance, if you take the first, here is an example, M 0 1, J 0 1, and M prime ABC and J prime ABC, so there are two flat lattices, the direct product is drawn here. There is something which is called a regular antilattice. People doing non-commutative lattices, they define it by some Green relations and other things. I'm not going to go into this. You can do it in a very combinatorial way. You say a regular antilattice is an antilattice that can be written as a direct product of flat antilattices. But then it's not difficult to see that this can be done if you have two flat lattices of the same type. I mean, they're both horizontal-horizontal, or vertical-vertical, or one horizontal, the other vertical, then the direct product will be of the same type. It will remain flat. So if you want to get something, let's say, then at most four antilattices, flat antilattices, must be multiplied an LL lattice, LR lattice, RL lattice, and RR flat lattice. So these are then regular antilattices, and if you want to prove the very form of reality, maybe you can just write down identities for regular antilattices, and that's the proof. Otherwise, you can use the direct tool for that. Okay, how do you enumerate finite regular antilattices for M? As I said, they are defined by four parameters. A, B, C, D is how big is, let's say, horizontal-horizontal part. Horizontal-vertical part is B. Vertical-horizontal C, and vertical-vertical D. So, in how many ways can you decompose M into the product, or the product of four elements? This is this sequence which appears in the online encyclopedia of integer sequences. That's how you enumerate finite regular antilattices. So on the other hand, if we want to enumerate just the types of antilattices, then you get a different story, a different picture. Okay. Remember that finite antilattices form a pseudo variety. So we are interested in taking substructures, homomorphic images, quotient structures, and taking finite direct products. So if you look at a rectangular band, so what are subbands of a rectangular band? It turns out that all you have to do is select some columns, select some rows, and this gives you substructure. So it's very easy to calculate how many rectangular bands of type BQU, how many subbands there are. For some antilattices, it's much more complicated because if you want to have a substructure here, you must have something which is subband here and also subband here. So it must be compatible on both matrices, and that's more complicated. So each antilattice has two types of trivial subantilattices: the antilattice itself, and each singleton is also a subantilattice. Now we can define something which I call elementary, or we could also call it prime antilattice. And that is an antilattice that has no other subantilattices, just the trivial ones. On the other hand, you can also look at the congruences and quotient antilattices. Now I'm using some ideas from this paper. So it was published in 2005, still has no citation, nobody looked at it. But I think it's very important, very interesting paper. Maybe you like it, I don't know. Okay, so if you want to look at the congruences in the quotient of antilattices, you have to know what is the Cartesian partition. Well, Cartesian partition is something that you take some, divide this into some columns and rows, and you do the same thing here. Of course, this is very simplified version because other people can have this not in the same order. You may have this part maybe a little bit here, a little bit down, so any permutation will still be okay. In such a way that this and maybe this are the same subantilattices, okay? So that the congruences can be described in this way. And each congruence in an antilattice can be described by a pair of Cartesian partitions. Okay, let's go to the figures of the magic square. I'm sure you all know it, right? It's on this Melancholia one. You'll find it in the top right corner. And there is a magic square. So, as any other magic square, not necessarily magic, any square, gives rise to an antilattice. Why? Okay, you take this canonical form on one side, and then you take the magic square on the right, and you interpret your interpretation of this is your matrix M, and this is your matrix J, and this is how an antilattice is defined, right? So, here is an example of a Cartesian partition of this antilattice. This means There are two congruence classes, the red one and the black one. So there is a quotient somewhere sitting there, and the question is how many quotients and how are they organized? Here's another one. And here are some of the congruences or Cartesian partitions from Rich's paper. I wrote a computer program and I found some more. So this is the lattice of congruences of Dürer's magic square. How much time? 5 minutes?
Still some.
Okay. Okay. So the worst or the best that can happen is that this lattice here of congruences has only two elements. The trivial partition, and so when every singleton is a coset, and the top where everything is a coset. In this case, the antilattice is called simple. This can go also to quasi-lattices, but we are interested only in antilattices in this case. And why are simple antilattices important? Because a simple quasi-lattice is either a lattice or an antilattice. Everything is known about lattices, and everything is known about antilattices. So simple quasi-lattices are simple. Of course, product of antilattices is never simple. That's the same as for groups. You know, if you get two products in groups, you know, it's very hard to find it simple. Now, there is another thing, because regular antilattices are products or flat antilattices. It follows immediately that a regular antilattice is simple if and only if its cardinality is less than 1 to 2. Also, every elementary lattice is simple. Elementary lattice is simple. The converse, of course, is not true. Now I'm going to introduce all antilattices. What are all antilattices? I will say that N is an odd antilattice if it has no subalgebra with two elements. Okay? If you think a little bit, you see there are no two elements, X and Y, that will appear here in one column and maybe here in the same column, in another column or row. So they must. That is forbidden, okay? If you find such a thing, then you know you have an antilattice of order 2. So, obviously, an elementary antilattice of order greater than 2 must be odd. However, simple antilattices need not be odd or elementary. There exist simple antilattices that are neither elementary nor odd. I'm sure that we'll get later. But I'll introduce a graph, and I think this should be somehow similar to, but not quite the same. I call it anti-diagonal graph of an antilattice. So what is an anti-diagonal graph of an antilattice? I say that two elements, let's say x and y, are adjacent in this anti-diagonal graph if they are both collinear, so they are both in the same row or column in each of the two matrices. So none of them is diagonal. in the diagonal position. There must be, there may be one lattice like this, in the other one like that, or both like this, so they are collinear in both lattices. And if you look at the Dirac lattice, then this would be anti-diagonal graph of Dirac's anti-lattice. These are the elements that appear, for instance, 5 and 9, they appear in both matrices, either in the same row or in row 1, row 1, column. Okay? Here is an example of a simple anti-lattice that is not elementary. This is the anti-lattice graph of this matrix, this anti-lattice. For instance, 2 is adjacent to 3 because 2 and 3 are in the same row here, and also in the same row here, and so on. So we can check these things. If you try to find Cartesian partition, you will see that there is no Cartesian partition in this case. Also, this anti-lattice has trivial automorphism group. So there is no permutation of, I mean, there is no permutation of group elements that would preserve the two operations. This follows, for instance, from the fact that its anti-diagonal graph has just this automorphism, 2 and 4 may be swapped. But if you try to swap 0 and 4, if you try to swap 0 and 4 there, you will see that you will not get isomorphic anti-lattice. So it's really in this particular case. You can use sometimes this graph to see. I don't know exactly what is the relationship between all the organisms of one and the other. One is certainly included, one automorphism group is included in the other one, but they're not the same. Okay, let's go now back to magic square, or at least same magic square. I'm taking 16 playing cards. They are strange. They are from Austrian Tarok. Anybody knows Tarok? Okay, some of us. All right. What is funny about these cards is that they have this funny figure on a horse. It's called Cavalier. And they have also Tarok cards. They are very nice, Roman numeral cards in the game. But anyway, you take this square, and then you may place it into a form of Greco Latin square, which is nothing else but a pair of orthogonal Latin squares, right? One Latin square is made of suits, and the other Latin square is made of ranks for cards. So now I can do the Greco Latin encoding in such a way that I give numbers to suits 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and also to ranks 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then I, for instance, king of spades is then 0, 0, and so on, okay? And then I transform this, I read it in base 4, and if you want, I can add 1 to every element. And that's how I get this square here, right? But if I place my set of cards, my deck of cards, in the shape of Greco-Latin square, that is a pair of orthogonal Latin squares, then I can use the same encoding to get two matrices. And the first one is the canonical one, and the second one is this one here, which is a symmetric square in this case. So this is an antilattice. So every pair of orthogonal Lattice squares gives you an antilattice. But wait, there are no two elements in the same row or in the same column. So this antilattice is odd. If you think a little bit, you see that this is also, if you have an odd antilattice, it must be square. There is no other way. So if you have a finite antilattice, then the following are equivalent. N is odd, N is recollecting, and anti-diagonal graph is empty. There's no edges. We just almost proved it, okay? So each elementary antilattice is square. There's a consequence to this. An odd antilattice of order n exists even only if n equals k squared, k is greater than 2, except for n premises. Elementary lattice of order n greater than 2 exists even only if n equals k squared. And it doesn't exist for n equals premises. Every sub-antilattice of an odd antilattice is odd. And in particular, it is square. So there is a question. Are there any orders, square orders, to which there is no elementary antilattice? People working in orthogonal Lattice square will surely know the answer. All the antilattices that are simple. There exist infinitely many odd antilattices that are simple. How do you prove that? Take PCP, a prime, you get a square. Now, if you want to have this, what I called Cartesian partition, if you think a little bit, each congruence class must be square, and this then tells you that everything must somehow be of the same type, so it should be the order of this, let's say, coset must divide the order of the whole thing, and that's impossible because P is prime. Now there is a very useful result on orthogonal Lattice squares that was proved by two mathematicians. One of them is Kathy Heinrich, she's a wife of Brian Alsop. They finish the proof of this theorem. If you have a pair of orthogonal n squares of order n, now n is just, so n times n, that's the square, okay? It can be embedded into a pair of orthogonal n squares of order v, that is v times v. Bigger than n, if and only if v is greater or equal to 3n, and v is not 6, and n is not 2 or 6. Okay? So every big Lattice square, every little Lattice square sits somewhere in some big Lattice square. It did not divide, v does not be divisible by n. That's important in this case. Because there exists infinitely many simple antilattices that are not elementary. Just use that with this. Here is an odd antilattice of order 81 that is neither simple nor elementary. It's just the direct product of two 3x3 antilattices. You see one example of these two sub-antilattices, which are sub-ends that are in the form of sub-antilattices. Okay, there is another important corollary. Let n be an odd n values of order n. If n is less than 18, then n, 81, then n is elementary. This is also a consequence of that result that I was talking about, small n square sitting in a larger n square. Thank you. Thank you very much for giving me time to tell you two things. I'll tell you a few things about the upcoming European Congress of Mathematics that will take place from July 5th to July 11th in Tomaž, Slovenia.
But that is Iran.
That is Iran, right? Well, Tomaž, Iran. Also, this thing is not, you see, it's just in the middle. So you may have how it's Piran or Tomaž, whatever you want. Anyway, we now open calls for mini symposia, satellite conferences, and exhibitors. So if your society would like to make an exhibition or whatever, say something, then you can rent a place and get it. Now, mini symposia, these are the deadline for mini symposia December 1st, 2019, and so we would like to get a large mini symposia. These are like how would I say it? Sections or sessions of a conference. We would like to get a lot of people come together and talk about similar things. These are the mini symposia. So there are special incentives for mini symposia organizers. And if you look at the web page, you'll get more information about that. So, if you organize a mini symposia, you don't have to pay congress fee. And if you have 20 or more oral contributions, then you have two active mini symposia participants without congress fee. And mini symposia students will have special treatment for getting grants to get to come to the congress. We have to give about 100 or more grants for students from less developed countries, but if you don't get them from less developed countries, we give them to other students. And of course, if you apply and you get a good letter of recommendation of your supervisor, then it's very good chance that you'll get this a student will get a scholarship, which means basically no conference fee. You will be able to stay in student dormitory and things like that. So it will be quite great. Right? Okay, there are four types of mini symposia contributions. There will be one keynote talk, 40 minutes, five longer talks, 30 minutes, and four or more short talks, 20 minutes, and as many posters as you want. Okay? The mini symposia organizer selects all participants of that mini symposium, active participants. If he or she doesn't like somebody, he said no. You should go in a regular session, and then we go to a regular session, okay? Other things are satellite conferences, there are internal and external satellite conferences. Deadline is February 1st, and again, you have to check the web page and you get all the information about that. Internal satellite conferences are basically at the same place, three days before or 3 days after the Congress, and there is only one Congress conference speed of this way, and we take care of your coffee breaks and other things, so we don't have to worry about that. External sector conferences, they should not be too far in place and in time. What we would like to have, if you have somebody who comes from China, or from the States, or from South Africa, or wherever, we would like to have just one flight to Europe and back. We don't want to get something that we go to, you know, to somewhere and then back. So this is not a separate topic, okay? There will be a lot of place for exhibitions, so if you publish books or do something, you have anything, you know, it would be good to be present there. So the council meeting, that's not for you, but that was when we presented in Prague, it will take place in Kiev. So your representative of your mathematical society, they will come to the day and have the council meeting there. So do come to Tirana or Koroš. Pertini was very important, not only in music, you know, but he also, in physics, he invented something for physics. There are some two close tones or notes or whatever, and something happens there. Okay, that's part one. Part two is the civilian aspect of the Black American Society. Okay? We became full member of the European Democratic Society just recently in Prague, June 23 or 24. Why? Well, why society? Well, first of all, of course, in Slovenia we had some good mathematicians in the past. Here are some of them. I don't want to use this too much. So, when was it founded, this society? Only in 2016. Where? In Koper, Slovenia. Who should be a member? Anyone who has an ID in Manzanet or Zabrada? How much does it cost? 20 euro per year. How many members do we have? So far we have about 50 members from Slovenia, Bosnia, Canada, Colombia, Italy, Hungary, Mexico, New Zealand, United States. No one from Russia. Okay, for 20 euro, for 20 euros per year, you get 20 euros discount for any congress or conference you organize. Okay? So you get back money needed. No problem. Why? That's another question. Well, it happened sometimes around 1980. Before that, Slovenia was totally continuous. Actually, complex. Not only continuous, complex. But then suddenly, an explosion of the script of the United States. And now about one third of Slovenian mathematicians are script mathematicians. And the reason is that we have one society which is mostly for high school teachers and for mathematicians. And also, if you think a little bit, the European Math Society is only PD, nothing else. So we want to have something strong in this field of mathematics. We would like to show, be an example for other countries to form a similar society, where discrete mathematics is also mentioned. You have many societies where the applied mathematics mentioned. Those societies, this is the first society in the world that is serious, so it's a member of the MS, where the discrete mathematics is mentioned. We publish, co-publish two journals. You probably know the size of the contemporary. But we started with a new, they're all free to read. You just go online and get all articles in India. Huge number, that's the problem. That's why we started a new, we call it ADAM, the Art of Discrete and Applied Mathematics. So this is AMC, that's 7. And we are co-publishers from the start. Here, we just joined right now. So why should be why not one? I don't know, maybe what we do, we cooperate journals, we issue books, we now issue a translation of this book on non-competitive lenses by Jonathan Leach. We are organizing conferences, or co-organizing conferences. This is the 8th conference that we already, we have already 8 conferences that we've organized, and we like international cooperation. We would like to have as many bilateral agreements as possible. You're welcome to join it, see our webpage, and there is also a possibility to join. Finally, the last slide. There will be a Times of the International Conference in Graph Theory, June 24-28 in 2019. I am on the scientific committee, but the big boss is not interested in work more, so you should ask him. We still don't know where this is going to take place. But it will be somewhere in Serbia. Thank you very much.
Okay, so we have a coffee break. Next lecture starts in 2:00.